India.
Carefully monitoring the new Delta.
Mark Drakeford is the fourth man to lead a Welsh government. He's been First Minister for just over 2.5 years, and in that time, the world has changed. We've followed him as he begins his last term of office, finding out more about him and what makes him tick. And we start at 6:30 on a Friday morning.
At home, I'll be listening to the Today programme and Good Morning Wales.
The First Minister is announcing easing of restrictions in Wales, and that means media interviews, lots of them, starting with Britain's brightest breakfast show.
This is Good Morning Britain with Charlotte Hawkins and Richard Madeley.
Well, I'm glad to say that Mark Drakeford joins us live now, fresh from his meeting yesterday with Boris Johnson.
If I called, for example, the editor of this programme an awful man and that I had a meeting with him, I'd be a bit embarrassed. Was there any tension or embarrassment there yesterday? Did you wish you hadn't said it?
I call the Prime Minister far less awful things than people in his own team are reported to call him. So that was certainly not mentioned and played no part at all in the conversation.
It's a good reply.
We're as confident as we can be that we've built those protections as high as possible.
Well, thank you very much for a series of unambiguous replies. It makes a change talking to a politician when they actually answer the question. Thank you very much indeed.
The members of his own team have called him far worse.
Regularly.
As one interview is done, another one is about to begin. This time outside the Welsh Government's headquarters in Cattaise Park in the middle of Cardiff. So as we wait, it's an ideal time for a catch-up.
Do you get nervous?
Yes.
You get nervous?
Yes.
We do this for a long time.
I know, but, you're only as good as your last one in this business. And, you could say something foolish in any interview. So, yeah, no, I always feel nervous before doing any interview.
Mark Drakeford is a political insider. He's worked in and around the Welsh Government since devolution was born. But he has done other things. He is Professor Mark Drakeford, a scholar of Latin and a former university lecturer. And it seems those years have taught him something.
An observation I've had about a lot of politicians in Wales, and you're in this category, is that you've got this rare quality of actually trying to answer the question you're asked.
Yes.
How do you fall into that habit?
Well, I honestly think it's because of the years I spent, teaching in the university, where, the idea is you do answer the question that you're asked. And so I've got into that bad habit.
Well, it's useful for us.
I know, I find it different. No, I think it's the right thing to do, isn't it, if you can... Your answer question, you do your best to answer it, rather than to provide an answer. There's nothing to do with it. I've marked exam papers, where the question is, what contribution did Queen Victoria make to something or other? And the first sentence says, in order to understand Queen Victoria, you really need to know. And then you get the essay on the subject that the person has learnt, rather than the question that's been asked.
So those academic years have taught you well in the handling of the media.
So it's just coming up to 8:10 in the morning and we're on interview number 5 so far. And by our count, there's about 14 interviews to be done today alongside meetings and press conferences. And there are new bids from organisations across the UK coming in all the time. Fridays at the moment are very busy for the First Minister.
Yesterday, the advice we had...
If the West Wing has CJ Craig, then the Welsh Government has Simon Jenkins, the First Minister's official spokesman.
Some occasions where we thought, oh gosh, we've got international interests as well, we've got CNN, we've got Al Jazeera, we've got sort of not complaining about the interest, but sometimes think, how are we going to fit 14, 15 interviews?
Because you haven't been set up for that. You haven't been used to it.
We haven't, but we reorganised ourselves very early on in the pandemic. And as soon as we started making decisions in Wales and announcing decisions ahead of England, and people realised that we could do something different, that's when the interest started to take off.
When you're up close with the First Minister, there are two things you notice. Firstly, how fast he walks.
I'm absolutely knackered watching you this morning. I don't know how you're carrying on.
The second, he's not fond of certain formal office wear.
I was given a T-shirt by my office here with a painted on type.
Was it?
On it, so, you know.
It's very kind.
It was.
They
could see just how keen I am. I hate wearing a tie. I constantly feel like I'm being strangled. If I was wearing what I would be most comfortable in, I'd have a T-shirt and shorts on.
The Welsh Government's headquarters in Cattaes Park is a grand building. It used to be the Wales office pre-devolution. Now it's where the Welsh Cabinet works. This is effectively our Welsh Whitehall. But what about our version of 10 Downing Street?
I am very lucky. I live 10 minutes across the park from where we are and quarter of an hour from down in the bay in the Senedd. And that means it's very easy for me and I wouldn't need anywhere other than I've got. But, you know, the day will come when the First Minister will be from North Wales. And that person will be needing to stay in Cardiff for lots of their working life. Now, it's one thing doing it as I do from my own home. It's a completely different matter if you don't have somewhere where you can regard as your own base. So you're right, Scotland, Northern Ireland and England all have bases where their First Minister or Prime Minister can live. And the time may well come here in Wales too, where that will be not just a matter of, you know, sort of advertising the nature of the institution, but it'll be a practical working necessity to allow a First Minister to do their job.
Any potential candidates for places in Cardiff, you think?
The place that Cardiff itself uses is the Mansion House, of course, where the Lord Mayor is based. That's a significant building, but it belongs to Cardiff as a city, and I'm quite sure they intend to go on using it for it.
But it's COVID, not buildings, on the front of his mind. Each day, he looks at the latest statistics.
The figures are inherently volatile. You think, you know, they're up in Carmarthen, Ceredigion and Pembrokeshire. But from those, you know, very small numbers.
Before the regular press conference, he has a briefing from his team about the questions which could come up and how he might answer them.
There's the breaking news about Pfizer, 12 to 15-year-olds.
Yeah, I just think, you know, it's an important step ahead. It opens the door to the JCVI now being able to consider its advice on vaccination of children in that age range.
I'm curious to find out how his increased high profile has affected him.
Some of your ministers have made it clear that they've had some real tough times this last year. Have you faced that?
Yeah, no, you do. Well, no, look, I do my best not to read any of it. You know, that's my defence is I do not spend my days reading, you know, the comments section in social media because I don't think it would be good for my welfare.
Are you actually on? I know you got presence on social media, but are you actually on social media? Look at it.
No, I don't. No.
Not on Facebook.
No.
Instagram posting pictures of dinner.
No.
No Twitter.
No.
Are you ever worried about your own security? Because you are exposed. You walk around. I've seen anybody walk up to you, have a photo. You're a high-profile politician.
Mm-hmm. You know, there are days when you think this is a sensible thing to do because anybody can stop you and anybody can say anything they like to you. But you make a judgment, don't you? And my judgment is that I think we are still a safe enough place that a First Minister in Wales can go shopping, can go, you know, can walk to work, can do the ordinary things that I try still to do.
And be filmed doing them.
And shoot, I went for a swim in Amaroth last week. So I'm in the water, it's cold, I'm swimming around, and this man is over there, and he swims up to me, and he says, do you know, you look just like Mark Drakeford. People must say that to you all the time. So I'm swimming around, saying, well, yes, actually I am. And there's a slipway in Amaroth where we are, and there's two 10-year-olds on there, and they're waving at me, saying, Mark Drakeford! And I thought, you can't be incognito.
This is the price of fame for
you. You can't be incognito. I must learn to swim up further out.
At 17 minutes past 12 precisely, he walks into the now familiar COVID press conference. These have become fixtures on daytime television. The First Minister is hardly Philip Schofield, but the public have been watching to find out the latest on the restrictions.
Thank you for joining me once again.
But while much of the focus over the last year or so has been on COVID, the business of government still goes on.
So it's 3 o'clock on Monday now, time for Cabinet. That's what the First Minister is doing behind me with his ministers and his deputy ministers. On the agenda, the budget, and also the programme for government, which is effectively the Welsh Queen's speech without all the fanfare.
Cabinet is confidential, but we did catch up with some of the ministers who are members of it.
How would you summarise Cabinet and the Welsh Government? Is it sort of a collective thing, or does the First Minister put his will on everyone, or is it big discussions? What's it like?
It's actually really collegiate, so everybody, I don't think anybody feels intimidated. I think there's a real understanding that everybody can say their honest opinion. There's a bit of direction always from the First Minister, but I genuinely think that particularly in COVID times, you know, we've kind of followed quite a set pattern, and particularly when we're deciding if we're going to open up or not, we look at the evidence, we listen to the experts, and then we have the political discussion and make a call.
You say he's the leader, of course. You ran against him, as did Vaughan Gethin. Once that's over, do you put it one side? Do you sort of still remember those days, or how does that work?
We kind of all know each other. I mean, I know Mark from when I was a child, when I was working in, I was a child in Ely, and he was a youth worker in Ely. So, you know, it's a relationship that goes back a long way, but it's obviously there's an absolute respect there, certainly from my point of view. So, you know, it wasn't at all difficult to be beaten by Mark Drakeford, I can assure you.
Are you tempted another time when it comes up?
I've absolutely got enough on my plate at the moment, I can tell you. It's highly unlikely.
The question I often get when there's been a reshuffle is, how can a minister go from, in your case, health to economy, being an expert on one thing, then all of a sudden, overnight, is an expert on a different subject altogether? Behind the scenes, how does it work? Do you have like an intensive weekend of having to study all this new subject?
Well, it's not just a weekend, it's quite a lot. And the challenge is, if you're in the world of work and you change your job, when you change being the health correspondent to being a different correspondent, you're still a journalist, but you're covering different subjects. Here, I'm still a politician and a decision maker. There's still advice, but I still need to learn more about the new area. And that happens more and more over time. I dare say I'll be even more confident in my role in another 3 months and 6 months. And I can honestly tell you, when I first became the Deputy Minister for Health, there were lots of very long nights in learning enough about the portfolio to be able to make choices. But people who change jobs in the world of work get used to that too. And you have to still do things in your job, even while you're learning. You just don't normally have to do that while answering questions on national TV, Rob.
I suppose not. Do you look at the First Minister and think, do you know what, I'd still quite like to do that job?
Well, I'm interested in the future, but there isn't a vacancy. And we have lots and lots of things to do now. The pandemic isn't finished. There's light at the end of the tunnel, but we're still in the tunnel. And I just don't think it'll be helpful to have lots of hairs running about the longer-term future.
I think you've said on record you probably would, wouldn't you?
Well, I'm not going to try and change my mind about those things, but I just don't think it's helpful to get into a conversation now. Regardless of how mischievously you smile at me,
we'll ask you another day.
I'm sure you will ask me another day. And between now and then, there'll be lots of other choices to make. I definitely have a much greater sense of optimism now compared to 6 months ago, where things were really, really hard. Things aren't easy now, but they're a different order of challenges and a much better place for us all.
One person who's seen many days in Cabinet is Jane Hutt. She has served every First Minister and the first and last First Secretary since the last century.
You're a senior minister, you say you were there right from the beginning, you had some big portfolios. Were you ever tempted to throw your hat in the ring to become the leader? At any point?
Well, it did at some midway point. It was put to me that perhaps I might consider it. But, you know, this is now where I've looked to see who is going to be the best leader. And I was very much a supporter, as you know, of Mark Drakeford becoming the leader when I backed him and Carwin stood down. So, but I do think it's very important that diversity of Wales is reflected in our leadership, and I'm sure that's where, for the future, for the next generation, I've played my part and I think hopefully been a role model for women in leadership.
So the next First Minister, a woman?
Well, we'll see. Let's see what happens. We got Mark Drakeford, and he, as long as he can possibly do it, he's here to be our First Minister.
Do you like to chair cabinet, hear all views, or do you come in and sort of, you know, this is what I think, you know, challenge me, Thatcher style?
No, my style is to come in towards the end of cabinet, generally. I think there's always a risk that if I say what I think in the beginning, that there's a bit of a skewing of the conversation to try and see if, you know, people think they can find a way of agreeing with you. And that's just inevitable, isn't it? So I prefer myself to, we have a paper, there'll be a minister's name attached to it. They always get the first chance to introduce it and set things out. Then I will see how many of my cabinet colleagues want to come in and ask questions or make contributions, or I'll do all of that. And then I'll tend to come in towards the end of the conversation, either, you know, adding to what people have said or summarising, more often summarising, where I think the weight of the conversation has got us to.
Aside from COVID, it's the government's plans in its programme for government which has been dominating thoughts in this building.
The climate change is clearly at the forefront of what you're thinking, but aren't you going to have to make some really difficult decisions in Wales about some, you know, our airport, for example, and what happens there?
You know, there are some very challenging decisions. But it was why, when we were crafting our manifesto, I felt so determined that we would do it in a way that was credible. So that doesn't mean that those difficult decisions have gone away, but it does mean that the things we said in the election are not going to, you know, add hugely to those difficulties, because we made promises that were well beyond what we knew would be possible.
By the time you leave office, will there have been a plan for the funding of social care? Because it's not in this plan you have today. So are you, by the time you leave office, will we know how we're going to fund future care in Wales?
Yeah, I certainly hope so. You know, the UK government had a 7-word sentence in their Queen's speech on social care. And when I've asked UK ministers about all of that, they have confirmed that their intention is to publish their plan in this calendar year. Well, we've done an enormous amount of work in Wales already, so we will certainly not be at anything like a standing start. When we've got those extra pieces of the jigsaw that can only come from the UK government, talking about how all this will interface with the benefit system, for example, then we should be in a position, you know, to move ahead. So that will certainly be within the time that I plan to be First Minister.
So the plan for Wales and social care maybe even start being implemented by the time you leave this office?
Yeah, I certainly hope so, provided the UK government actually do deliver.
And if they don't, then you have to do it on your own?
Well, that's much harder, because we will then be inevitably planning in the dark. If we have yet another delay and we can't see when that is going to come our way, then we will have to think about what we can do on our own. But that is not the best way of doing things.
We may be living in the middle of a pandemic, but you still have to scrutinise the government, and that's what this place is for. But it still has a hybrid system. So some members are in the building and some are not. But the member for Cardiff West certainly is. That's the First Minister. Today, Tuesday, is First Minister's Questions, and he is preparing.
UK-Australia trade deal, that may come up.
I saw that Welsh lamb was on the menu at the meeting, which seemed pretty symbolic to me.
So you're heading to FMQs and this is all your data?
Yeah, this is Tuesday morning, really. So the morning is a constant arrival of new things that need to be read or looked at or thought about beforehand. And, it is a struggle to fit what needs to be done into the time available.
He's got to have a good memory in this job, hasn't he?
Well, there's a lot of learning to be done, yes.
Mark Drakeford walks back into the Senate a more confident man. Last month's elections saw an increased number of Labour MSs, the party outperforming his own private expectations. But he knows, on key issues like the budget, he will have to talk to other parties. And First Minister's Questions is a chance for all of them, in person or remotely, to come together in the chamber.
Are you looking forward to FMQs?
I'm always looking forward to FMQs. What's your approach? You're going to land a punch or you're going to gather information?
I'm more of a gentle, softer approach to things these days. Debate and discussion achieves more.
An impartial observer of First Minister's questions might suggest that it doesn't quite have the political drama of, say, Prime Minister's questions in Westminster. But just like we had asked the First Minister about climate change and funding social care, so did the opposition parties.
Well, I think it's a perfectly reasonable question, since your programme for government does touch on income tax rates and whether the government will use them or not. Also, what's talked about are particular levies or surcharges for social care or indeed education, which was highlighted on the weekend by an academic here in Cardiff. So you have to pay for services some way, either through taxation or through levies or surcharges. So what is your preferred route then, First Minister, if you're not prepared to give an indication of what you're likely to do with Welsh income tax? Do you believe that there should be a sector-specific surcharge on social care?
We have a higher proportion of our population over 65 than any other part of the United Kingdom. We're the only part of the United Kingdom where people move into Wales at the age of 65 to retire. And we have to think together about how that is to be paid for in the future.
Tackling climate change, we have to be serious about tackling energy use in buildings. When are we going to see work beginning in earnest and at scale on the kind of retrofitting of heating and insulation needed to get us to where we need to go?
The energy that is given off by the houses we live in is one of the major challenges we face.
In an unusual move, the First Minister said he'd be stepping down in this term before he was even elected Labour leader. So at some point, in a few years' time, he will answer his last First Minister's question.
You are going to be stepping down at some point. Are you going to miss it?
Oh, well, inevitably, I suppose. It's a long way off, Rob, so I'm not thinking about whether I'll miss it yet. But, you know, the sort of job like this, it's a... It's like being on an escalator. You know, you're moving all the time. There's always something going on, and a Tuesday morning is particularly like that. So, you know, when you get off the escalator, you aren't going to miss it, don't you?
And will the escalator also mean the last term in the Senate for you?
Yes. Yes, I don't plan to stand again for election.
He walks very fast. And that's the way it is. This was a chance for us to speak to the most powerful man in Wales, find out a bit more about him, ask him questions we don't often ask him. Hope you found it enlightening. Next week, it's back to normal, but on Tuesday night. See you then. Nostar.